some years, and it was a different era and a different way of viewing television. And I played different characters each time I came on the show. So that was great fun, and I did the combat, and the Untouchables, and Medical Center, and a bunch of different shows that predated my appearance on Star Trek. One of the Mr. Bobad shows. There's an interesting story here, and it really is a reflection on the capriciousness of this. Can you all hear me? The capriciousness of this business that we're in, that I'm in. You hope that when you start a career, that there's room for advancement. And if you do well, there's a kind of a logical step forward that you make every so often because of your growing knowledge and expertise and maturity, etc., etc. At least that's the way we were taught, that you'll be rewarded if you put your nose to the grindstone and work hard. Acting is a very strange career. You can work your whole life, be extremely talented, and nobody will ever hear of you. You'll be doing 99 seat theater for 30, 40 years, and you never receive the recognition that you should, that you deserve on the basis of talent. I know many actors like this. And then there's the, he was a fish out of water when he went to this school. It was very kind of restrained by the book kind of young man. And that's the way I read for the role. I read those attitudes in place. And the director loved it. It was great, just great. And I walked away thinking that I had the role. And fortunately, as I said, I had contact with the casting director. The casting director, in fact, told me, he called me later that day and said, the director really liked you. I'll let you know when we're going to start shooting. Well, a couple of days went by and I didn't hear anything. And he called me back, the casting director called me back and said, oh, well, you know what happened was that we didn't like the script. The production team and the director. So they're rewriting the script. And while they're rewriting the script, they're looking at other actors for the role. Because the director has nothing else to do. So an actor came in, a foreign actor. An actor from Greece, as a matter of fact, who had been in a major motion picture, and he read for the role. And he was very, to put it euphemistically, he was very flamboyant. He was all over the place. He read it completely different than I had. This is really the casting director told me. And I saw no reason, no rationale, and no honest interpretation that could be given based on the way the character was written. So I was very perplexed. And my friend the casting director said, by the way, the director loved it, loved his performance. I'll let you read between the lines after I tell you the next. So he said, had me come back, and he asked me to read it, and to read it the way some actor had. He didn't tell me that somebody had read it this way. If I had not known that he wanted me to replicate or imitate another actor's performance, if I had not known that, I would have tried. I'm an actor with training, and you're given, in the course of becoming an actor, and your exercises and lessons that require you to try things that are out of the ordinary. And if I thought this was the director's choice, I would have tried it. I don't know how the hell I could do it, but I would have tried it. But knowing that he wanted me to repeat another actor's performance and judging me against another actor in an interpretation that I thought was totally unreasonable, I had to decline. I said, I'm sorry, I can't justify what you're asking me to do. He wanted me to scream, rant, cry, And he said, well, you don't have the role if you don't try. And I said, I can't. So I went home. I didn't have the role. That was the end of it, right? That's the end. Capricious. I called him, my friend, cast director, the following Monday. I said, I've got to come down and watch this guy work, this young man work. Because I've got to see how we can make this. I mean, I can learn something from this. And my friend said, oh, I guess you didn't hear. One of the regulars of the show, Gene Jagger, became ill. And since he was so heavily involved in this episode, they decided to postpone it. 6 weeks go by, Gene Jagger is now well. That director isn't available. They bring in another director. My friend calls me back in. I read one line, and he says, you have the part. Part of the Russian student. That casting director was also, 3 years later, the casting director on Star Trek. So, that's how things, not all the time. I mean, there are wonderful actors who have been compensated and rewarded for their talent. There's no question about it. But it's also possible that you can go a whole lifetime and not receive the recognition, or receive recognition that you don't deserve. And that's, I think, a little different than the structured world that most of the guys live in. Boy, what a long speech.
It's a great story. Thank you.
And what was it like returning to the role of Chekov in the movies after the show was over? Do you have any apprehension about returning to that role in the films?
Did I have any apprehension of returning to the films? No, I thought, great, I'm going to get paid again. And that was a terrific experience. Since I'm telling you personal stories, after Star Trek II, which was a sizable role for me, you know, and I had a considerable more to do than I had in general on the series, I thought that Star Trek III was going to be another jump. You know, I'm still thinking like, if you do well, you get promoted. Well, Star Trek, I was asked to come in. No, I was made an offer. I didn't accept the offer, which was pretty much the way things were. You don't accept the first offer. You just don't. It's a rule of thumb. And then I read, and then I asked them, can I read the script in advance? And they said, okay. So I came in, my agent drove me in, and I sat down and read the script. I was very disappointed. I had really expected there be more for me to do. I had finally left behind the Warp Factor 2 II dialogue that I had in the television series. And particularly with the work that I had offered to do in Star Trek 2. So, my agent, And the producer had said, I'll come down and talk to you after you read it. And I said, fine. Well, my agent said, after we finished reading it, he said, we gotta go. I brought you here and I gotta take you back. I got something else to go. So I told the secretary that we couldn't stay. We had to go home. But that I was disappointed. And I thought that was the end of it. I mean, okay, I'm disappointed. What does that mean? It just means that I'm disappointed. I'm not Bill Shatner, I'm not going to be able to make them change their mind, influence them anyway, and that's certainly the way I felt. But I felt I should concisely, succinctly describe how I felt. I got a call from my agent an hour later, and he said, Bennett, he's the guy, called him, raving about me, ranting and raving. How dare he not like this? What I wrote. This guy wouldn't work. You know, if he didn't have the Russian accent, he would never work in Hollywood. And he went on and on, and he said, this is a take it or leave it offer. And then he hung up the phone. Well, that was just was just too, that was just too insulting. There was no way that I was going to back down. You can't talk to me that way and expect me to get down on my knees and thank you for it. So I told my agent, well, to leave it, and I'm done with Star Trek. And I called my family together and I told them Star Trek. I said, I'm no longer involved in Star Trek. The next day, the phone ring rang with another offer. It's a bizarre one. I really thought it was over. But again, next time it turned to my benefit. I didn't think they cared enough or it was important for them enough for me to be in it. And as it turned out, lo and behold, it was. We had a terrible relationship, myself and Mr. Bennett, throughout the whole shooting of Star Trek. But that notwithstanding, I did the part. I did this to the best of my ability. And then, of course, went on to do several more. No. Oh, yeah, I asked him.
A more existential question for you, Walter. So, can you talk to us about what it was like to play a Russian character during a time of Cold War, during a time when sentiment, against the Russians was really high? And can you also tell us how that maybe influences your perspective in regards to today's current political climate?
Influences my perspective as to
today's current political climate.
Today's?
Yeah. I told you it would be existential.
I didn't know we were going to get into that. I know you guys did not pay to hear me talk about politics. However, I'm so passionate that I'm going to say a few words and then we'll go on to other things. But let me answer the first part of the question. How did people feel coming back to do, what was interesting?
The first part is, just talk to us about what it was like to play a Russian character during the time of the Cold War when sentiment, against the Russians was really high. What was that like for you as an actor to be the face of that character?
Okay, that's a good question. And absolutely no effect on me at all. In fact, my parents were both from Soviet Union. And they had a very different attitude about communism. My father was a devout commie. That didn't mean he was having midnight meetings with people who built bombs. It meant that he believed in communism as an economic and social philosophy. Could be more successful than our democratic society. And he was very outspoken about it. He was an idealist, and he believed that this was a thing that could work. Well, I think we've all learned that it doesn't work, Just as democracy has its failings and its traps, in my opinion, most characterized by the current administration, but I felt very bad that my dad didn't get to see me play in Russia. That's the only thing that affected me. Otherwise, I was just a character. It was something that I took on, that I found in myself. I found that boisterous, outgoing character that I never really examined. When I played a role, particularly when I was in college or I was in drama school, I was always looking for the sensitive part of the character. One of my teachers had said to me, God, I'm really confessing to you guys. It's really amazing. One of my teachers said, Walter, your point of view, your personal comment on life is self-pity. And I was really stunned for a moment. And then I realized, my God, he's right. I'm playing all this stuff from internal pain. And where is the optimist? Where is the young, aggressive, vital human being who believes that the world not talking literally. I was so comfortable playing this pain thing that it never occurred to me. And it opened up a whole new world in terms of who I was. Because it was in me, I just never exercised it. So when it came to reading for Chekhov, the lines were very, very dark. And you may have heard this story before. I apologize to those who went through it again. I was asked, I saw there was dialogue. Kicked it, the sheep is about to explode. I thought it was going to talk. And that thing seemed to be what the character was saying. And I finished reading it, and everybody kind of became very silent. There was about seven people in the room, Jim Roddenberry, two of the directors, executive producer, a lot of people. And they said, yeah, Walter, that was good, but can you make it funny? Okay, this is going to be the director. It's not coming because some other actor had done it funny. Okay, so I felt duty bound to find a way to make this funny. So my next reading was, Captain, guess what? The sheep is about to blow up. That's what got me the part. What was the second part of the music?
Well, I don't know if you want to answer the second part of the question. That was great. The second part is, just kind of carrying that over into how you, you're playing that Russian character during the time of the war, how that impacts how you look at our current political climate.
Oh, well, politically he was an innocuous character. Other than that, this was acquainted by a little old lady in Leningrad. Chekhov was not really a controversial character. He was brought up to appeal to the very young, the 8 to 12-year-olds, white paper and pencil, and succeeded. They didn't know I was 31 at the time and married, not really Russian, American born. But it succeeded. I got a great deal of mail, and we filled that demographic with a character. So I don't know how it really compares to what we have today. The Russia that we're dealing with is, hey folks, it's an enemy, It's not our brother. It's not an ally. And this propaganda that we've been exposed to is the big lie. And I find it extraordinary that I am now defending a position that was contrary to what I defended as a kid. I mean, my dad was a commie, so I believe that all that stuff could happen, and that Russia was a good idea. And now that Russia is not a good idea, it's oligarchy, and they are our enemy, and they are against us, and they are plotting against us in one way or another, my feeling. The American government has taken 100% turnaround, and we have a whole different idea. It reminds me of something out of 1984, where they're giving us a new message, and the message is not real. Anyway, I know there are people out there saying, oh my God, he hates Trump. Yeah. That's the best I can answer.
That was great.
So lighten things up a little bit more.
Yeah, please, great.
You alluded to having Mr. Roddenberry at some of your table readings. Did you have much of a relationship with Gene Roddenberry?
No, it wasn't very strong. It was genial. It was pleasant. He'd come down to the set once in a while. that was prevalent in the industry, and specifically in our community, our Star Trek community. You are a secondary character. So my point was, when we did Star Trek 3, the first outfit they gave me was pink. It was pink with a white collar. And I thought, this is really so wrong. But I put it on, and we did the first day's shoot. And then the second day, and then they saw Dailies the next day, and Leonard came up to me, he was the director, and he says, the people who watch Dailies, the producers, were not happy with the outfit, and we were going to change it. And I said, oh, thank God. But he said, well, why didn't you say something? I mean, really got upset. It was embarrassing to him that they, and I said, say something. And my point was, I had been conditioned not to say anything. I had been conditioned to just be a loyal servant, you know, in the army. So, and then I realized, wait a second, that's what I had determined. Nobody told me that, but that's what I had learned to believe in a very subtle way. Very subtle way that I can't even describe to you the words that would have made me feel that way. It's just an atmosphere. And we were, from the series days, we were still subordinate personalities. And I just carried that over. It was a decade later. It was a decade later. And I still believe that could be the case. And then I realized that that was not true. And I became a little bit more vocal. I never became a problem. But I became a little bit, well, I did become a problem with Star Trek 3. With Art Bennett. But in any case, I'm really, really rambling here. So let's go back to something specific.
Well, I think Grant's actually going to take some questions up to the audience now.
Okay.
So questions, raise your hand, Grant, come around.
Junior front row, so congratulations.
I just wanted to ask you, you talked about advancement in your career and so forth. Do you feel like your being on Star Trek hurt that or helped that? Because after Star Trek, that's kind of like a big, huge thing. You get typecast. Do you feel you have that happen or do you feel it advanced?
Well, I'm extraordinarily, inordinately grateful to Star Trek. I'm not a company man, but I have an undying gratitude. That said, I would certainly like, would have liked my career to have expanded, to have given me opportunities apart from science fiction. But that had less to do with typecasting and to who I was. See, I was bankable in my 20s because I looked younger than I was, and I did a lot of the stuff that I did was before Star Trek. And after Star Trek, I really couldn't play those roles anymore. I couldn't play a character that was 9 or 10 years younger than I was. And I am not the, and I'm short, and the roles that were available to me had more to do with who I was physically, I think, than the fact that I was so entrenched with a particular type of role. You know, on the other hand, I did do Babylon 5, and that was terrific fun. I thoroughly enjoyed that. And my size made no difference. In fact, people, God, I'm 82, folks, so I wonder a little bit, you know. You gotta bear with me. But I'm asked why Vester had a frozen hand. Vester had a frozen hand for a very specific reason. I felt that if I had a disability, that I could believe in personally, I could be stronger for that. that I had achieved this rank, this position in the society as a head of the Psych Corps, a head, that I am really a person of magnitude and influence and power, etc., and that I could face up to two guys who are 6'2" and not bring Walter Koenig into it, who was, 10 inches or whatever it was, 9 inches shorter than they were, but that I could be more fully invested in Mr. Bester, who did not let things like a disability get in his way. And I could buy into that, and made me feel strong, and made me feel like I was an equal. And Joe Straczynski never said a word. It was just my idea, and he went with it. Now you all have to pause one moment. You can pray if you want. I thought I was going to sneeze. I was sure I was going to sneeze. You mean like jokes or something like that?
Yeah, jokes or just memories that you have while filming.
Well, I had a wonderful time doing the voyage home. That to me was just terrific. I mean, the character was really principal to the story. He had his own music. I remember standing in the parking lot up in San Francisco and just come out of makeup or something and say, don't forget this experience, because this is what acting is, and it's really about and expressed. We really are involved in the process when you're making a tangible contribution. And I said, remember this, and I act. Never repeated that before. So Star Trek IV in general, in particular, in specific moments, it wasn't when Mr. Shatner's hairpiece fell off. So I can say that. I enjoy working on all of them. I think 11 of the 12, Bester was very instrumental in the story. It's part of the plot line. The one that probably was most effective was the one where I played opposite Jerry Doyle, and we were in a train, and there was a lot of close-ups back and forth, and I was sort of intimidating him. Intimidating this character. And that was a powerful episode of one where I felt the character was really in command and I had an opportunity to really go for it. So that was the one, I don't remember the name of it, but that was the one that I loved the best.
Yes, you can.
First, I'd like to say it is wonderful to get to talk to you because I grew up watching classic Star Trek episodes on VHS. How does it feel to be part of just one of the best sci-fi franchises ever?
It's terrific. It's terrific because it really stood for something. There are a couple of things about Star Trek that I particularly embrace. Star Trek because my dad and my mom watched it, and I watched it with them. And what they're saying, what is to be inferred, is that it strengthened that bond between parent and child. And I think, hey, that's a great thing. That's a great thing. And it's something that I think Star Trek, in an indirect way, in a way that was not necessarily stated in our stories, but it influenced, it had an influence, which I think is just wonderful. The other thing is, yes, the stories were provocative and topical, and we could relate to them in a sociopolitical way, but even more to the point, so we had a bridge in which we had an African-American, a Japanese-American, we had a woman in a position of power, we had a Scottish character, we had a Russian character, we had what we hope, and what we, which was, this was what was stated, not on the page, but in the concept of the series, is that the world that we hope we would someday achieve, where we can all work together, be together, care for each other, look out for each other, be undivided in matters of humanity, and that is the most important thing to me. That's why I'm most proud being a part of Star Trek. Because he was doing that at the time. Gene Roddenberry brought that to us at a time he wasn't having it.
I feel unworthy to ask, but may I please shake hands with you?
May you shake my what? Yes. My son is buried, and it turns out to be the same cemetery where Anton Yeltsin is. They have a magnificent statue of him in that cemetery. It's a great tragedy. We lost such not only a talented human being, but a good person, a really good person. We need all that we can get.
Hi, was there ever any aspect of your character that was your input that you could add to it, or maybe a storyline that you suggested for your character?
Well, I don't think I suggested any video storylines. Whatever you saw on the screen was me. mean, I didn't like the dialogue, but the interpretation is mine. Nobody ever said to me, Walter, do it this way, do it that way. It just gave me my head, and I just went about doing what I instinctively felt was right. I think, you know, on a couple occasions, when we started making the movies, I did once have the temerity to, I think that's the right word, maybe it's not, to tell Gene about, see, in Star Trek, remember when I get burned, if you recall the movie, well, there was a line about, Kirk says, don't interfere, or something, or maybe it was Steve Collins. And I say, absolutely, I'm going to not interfere. And that was my mind. And of course, the improvised scene that we did, can you tell me where the nuclear weapons are? That was entirely improvised. They just said, you know, ask for it. And the young woman who came, I noticed her, the young woman who came up to me and said, well, I believe it's an Alameda across the bay. She wasn't part of our company. She was a woman walking her little, very unpleasant dog. And she stopped, she heard me talking, and she stopped and answered my question. So whatever dialogue that followed that again was improvised. I thought they were going to kill the shot and reshoot it. They reshot it only to make sure we had it. Because it was one of those surreptitious moments that they work out so well. Not surreptitious, totally more. Again, it's what's the word? Serendipitous. Thank you.
Got time for about two more questions.
So I know that normally several takes will be done of a scene. Can you relate one or two instances where you interpreted the scene in a way that you really liked, it could be Star Trek or Babylon 5 or wherever, and they used a different take, and you wish they'd use one?
Have you worked professionally as an actor?
I'm serious.
You know, because that happens all the time. It's very frustrating. I don't really recall it happening, either in Babylon 5 or on Star Trek. It may have, but I never had that much to do on Star Trek that I'd have to try to find another way to do it. I mean, that was the only way it was available. And Babylon 5, there was sufficient respect for all the actors to pretty much go along with what they felt intuitively. But I know that has happened. I had done other shows, independent films, where I really liked something, and I said, God, don't let them do a retake. And they did, and I asked them to do it a different way. Yeah, so that is a little annoying. In fact, I just did it. I went down to Louisiana, Shreveport, and I did a short film, and I was pretty happy with it. I had a good time, but the director asked me on applications to, I'm not sniffing up my nose, any coke or anything. It's an allergy thing, I don't know what that is. But I was hoping that they wouldn't reshoot it and he wanted that to shut. Worse is to do something that you really think is great. And you see the final edit, and it's not in there. That's really disappointing. One more question.
One more, thank you.
All right. Young fan, are you ready?
When did you start acting?
Where were you? Oh, how old are you? If you're asking me, I don't know. Well, there's a good reason why I asked that. When I was 8 years old, I went to a camp with my parents. It was a camp for intellectuals. They all had horn-rimmed glasses and smoked pipes, meaning women. No, rather. And I was the only kid. And they did a play. And they asked me to be in it. And I'm going to try once. I'm probably screwing up. But I think I remember the lines. The lines were, the Hans-Tassmann experiment from uranium-235 indicates that neutrons were also used during the fission process, and the trigger to set off atomic breakdown consists of a bit of uranium and a pinch of U-235. Pour these ingredients to a wooden bowl, stir vigorously, place in an oven, bake violently. After a temperature of 250 electron volts per split uranium atom, garnish with radioactive energy. That's the reaction I got. Can I have this for the rest of my life? But that being that I decided I was going to be an actor, I probably drew upon that among many other things when I made that final determination. But I knew that there might be some talent in that direction, and certainly an influence for when I did decide, which didn't really happen in my life until I was nearly graduated in college with a degree in psychology. And I took one class in acting, and my professor became a very enthusiastic supporter of mine. And this ended up, no, there's nothing to laugh about that. There's no intent, there's no hidden intent in that. I'm straight, he was straight, you know what I mean? But he sent me, he was a representative of drama school in New York, and they were in Playhouse, and sent me back there. So I was actually, when I started the Maple Class, I was 22, and that's when I said, this is for me. This is what I want to do for the rest of my life. Okay, thank you very much.